Hallelujah. Surely it is a privilege and an honor to be with you tonight. I want you to go with me to the book of Romans, the 12th chapter. Romans, the 12th chapter. We're going to start there at the first verse. I do honor our great chief overseer, Bishop C.K. Butler, to the building elder, Darlene Mumford. What a privilege it is to speak to you tonight as it relates to the Word of God and all that God has for us. Romans, the 12th chapter, I'm going to start at the first and read the second verse in your hearing. It says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you will present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I want to share with you for the next 10 minutes from this subject, be converted. Be converted. When I think about the condition of man today and the plight of humanity, I want to share with you, I believe in this hour that we, the body of Christ, must teach, admonish, share with men and women the necessity, if you will, of being converted. I believe to be converted is to have a change of perspective. To have a change of perspective. In order to be converted, you first must understand that you are a sinner. You are a sinner that needs to be saved by grace. And when I say you are a sinner, that does not mean you may or may not have engaged in what some people call the worst sins of the world. You may be a killer. You may be a liar. You may be a thief. You may simply be one who is not always consistent with keeping their word. But no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, I want you to know that all unrighteousness is sin, and we must be converted. Who needs to be converted? I believe that every man, woman, boy, or girl, before they come into the knowledge of Christ and who he is, he has a condition in his heart called sin, and therefore must be converted. Well, how do you know? Jeremiah, the 17th chapter, the 19th verse says, the heart of man is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Whom can know it? Psalms 56:3 says, the wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray soon as they are born, speaking lies. We all, at one point in time in our lives, needed to be converted. To be converted means you have a transfer or a change of mind. I had the privilege, the honor, to travel over to Rome, Italy. For 11 days, I was there staying in these hotels, visiting places like the Colosseum. I was in Venice at St. Mark's Cathedral. I got to see the 16th chapel. I was able to see the incorruptible Pope. I was able to walk the corridors of Capri, to go underneath the mountain. While in Rome, there were a few things that were different. Number one, they had Coke that looked the same, but it tastes totally different. They had McDonald's, but nobody wanted to eat there because we were eating authentic Italian food. But moreover, in all of my travels, one of the most interesting things was that the ladies who traveled with us, they would bring things like blow dryers and curling irons. And what I thought was so interesting was that even though that they had the same kind of outlet or plug that we use, in order for the ladies from America to hook up their blow dryers, hair dryers, they needed a converter between their products and the outlets that were in Rome. And it was the conversion process of the conversion process that allowed them to hook up an American hair dryer to a Roman outlet. I thought that was so interesting. Even today, as I consider the act of conversion, it is the only way today a black soul like you and like yours and mine, black with sin, and it converts it by dipping it into the red blood of Jesus, and therefore bringing it out something that is whiter than snow. When we think of conversion, we think of that process of taking that which is old and making it new. And we think of that which taking that which is dead and giving it life again. When we think of conversion, we think of the process of taking that which is useless, that has no value, and giving it value only because it is converted. Let's consider the text for a moment. The scripture says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you would do what? Present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. It says, which is holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Conversion is the ability to take those things, that person that we are, and giving that to God. When we say, God, here's my hands. You can use them in your service. Lord, here's my feet. Take them. You use them in your service. Lord, here's my tongue. Take it in your service. But how will I be converted, Pastor? Well, the process of conversion is explained in the second verse of that chapter, 12th chapter of Romans, when it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind. If you're going to be converted, you must have a revelation of transformation. If you're going to be converted, you must have a revelation of transformation. When one receives a revelation, it is the act of communicating truth. It is the act of something supernatural being revealed. A revelation is when one's view is changed. When something is revealed, it is when one is enlightened or astonished. If you're going to be converted, you must receive the revelation of the Word of God. If you're going to be converted, you must have a revelation of who God is. You have to have a revelation of what His Word says. You cannot be converted by good music. Thank God for all the musicians. You cannot even be converted by nice pews and beautiful sanctuaries. But if you're going to be converted, you must take the Word of God and you must begin to apply it to your heart. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. And as you take the Word and begin to eat the Word, you will be able to do what the scripture says as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to your former lust or in the lust of ignorance, but as He which hath called you to be holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. What is conversion? Conversion is the act of taking our sin-sick soul and giving us an opportunity at holiness and sanctification. How does that happen? It happens through the renewing of our mind. But the problem is that many of us are trying to be convinced and not converted. The problem of being convinced of a thing is that once you are convinced one way, you can be convinced another way. If you've been convinced to do this, you can then be convinced to do that. But when you are truly converted, it happens down in the recesses of your heart. You begin to pray prayers like David prayed. Create in me a clean heart and renew the right spirit in me, O God. To be converted is to say, God, not I, but Christ that lives in me. I may not know everything. I may not understand everything, but God, I want to be what you say be. I want to do what you say do. When I think of conversion, I think of repentance. I think of giving my all to God. I can think of saying things like, Lord, I want to do better. I want to be better. To be converted means to change something, to be different, to be used in a different way. To be converted is to have a change of systems and methods. To be converted is to have a change from one form or another to another. brothers and sisters, when I'm saying be converted, I'm saying you must take this opportunity to say, God created me a clean heart and renew the right spirit in me. I consider many conversions, and I think about old man David, who sinned time and time again, who sinned as he slept with that man's wife on the rooftop. But we find him, after being converted, penning such psalms like, "Oh God, thou art God, early will I seek thee. My soul thirsted after thee, flesh longeth for thee. In a dry and thirsty place, where there is no water." Conversion is when not only our mind changes, but I believe our appetite changes. When we're converted, we don't even long for the things of the world anymore. When we're converted, we're transformed. It causes us to have a different perspective, and then a different mind, and finally, a different action. Conversion will not just start in the mind, but it will translate even to our very actions. If you are converted, it'll start in your mind, and you will believe the word of God. But as you believe the word of God, you will begin to walk in the things of God. May not get everything right, but you'll get a desire and a hunger and a thirst after God. And you'll begin to use that hunger, that thirst after righteousness, to chase after God, to be all that he called you to be. So I encourage you today, be converted. Every liar, be converted. Every cheater, be converted. Every backbiter, be converted. The slothful saint, be converted. The messy missionary, be converted. The promiscuous preacher, be converted. Because when we are converted, we will have a change in the way we walk, a change in the way we talk, a change in the way we live, and we will be able to take hold of all things that God has for us. Many people want the Holy Ghost, but I believe that if you really want the Holy Ghost, you must first be converted. You must believe that Jesus is the Lord. You must be able to believe that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. What is my prayer for you today? My prayer is not for big houses, it's not for fancy cars, but my prayer is for you today that you be converted.